Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Let's come on in and get settled. It's so good to have you here this morning. And I think people are still kind of getting used to going back to church and seeing each other, being in this space. So there's lots of happy sounds as everyone comes in. Welcome to those of you who are joining us online. And I'm Jenny, and I'm the pastor here at Valley Presbyterian. And I just hope as you're in this space today that you feel at home, that you feel and sense your soul lifted into the presence of God as we are together this morning. A few announcements just to begin. This is the season of Lent, and during Lent, I'm hosting 7:30 a.m. prayer time on Zoom on Tuesday mornings. The details are on our website, and I think in the newsletter that came out today, or the little morning email you got, but you're welcome to join me at 7:30. I'll confess, I think I got up at 7:15 this last Tuesday, so, you know, bedheads and coffee are welcome. Next week, I'll be interviewing Ann Hillman in our service for our sermon. And if you know Ann, you know that any conversation with her is a sermon. And Ann has been a beloved member of our congregation for many years, and she's moving to Southern California at the end of March. So next Sunday will be our chance to say goodbye to Ann. We'll have a little reception after the service. So I encourage you to be here next week. This Sunday service has dual purposes. It is our normal Sunday service, but is also the concluding service of our women's retreat that we've had this weekend. Usually the women's retreat is in Santa Cruz, but wanting to make sure that we could have the women's retreat in a way that would make us all feel comfortable given our recent COVID conditions. We had the women's retreat up here, so you should have seen it on Friday night and yesterday morning. There were pillows and women were sitting on the ground, and we had our retreat here, and then we went to Half Moon Bay yesterday afternoon, and then we had a celebration last night at Alpine Hills with some more talking and sharing and some dancing. So we're going to share some of what we've been doing at the retreat and wrap that up, but in a way that brings you all along. And don't worry, I won't be asking you to dance this morning. But if you want to dance during the music, you know, you're welcome. I'm sure Jeff and Barbary won't mind. So welcome, Jeff. Thank you for being here to play guitar with us. We'll be hearing from other friends from the retreat who I'll introduce as we go. So let's take a deep breath to go from the getting here to the being here. Ready to receive God in this place. The phrase we were working with this weekend was still here. Celebrating that after the last 2 years, we are still here. Inviting us to be still here. So I'll begin by singing, and if you know this song, you're welcome to join me as it goes along. I will be still, I will be still, I will be still. And know that you are God. I will be still, I will be still, I will be still again. One more time. I will be still, I will be still, I will be still, and know that you are God. I will be still. I will be still. I will be still again. I'd like to invite Rian to lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. O Lord, my heart is not lifted up. I do not occupy myself with things too great. But I have calmed and quieted my soul. O Israel, hope in the Lord. Mother and God, embrace us in your fierce love. Enfold us in your protective care. Calm our anxious worrying. Quieten our teeming minds. Still us, body and mind and spirit, to rest in you like a weaned child. Amen.
Our opening hymn, number 735, I Need Thee Every Hour.
Good morning. My name is Jenny. I'm the Jenny who has fun playing parachute games with the children in the Redwood Grove and spending time with them in our cozy new nursery. Please join me as we pause and make space in our worship service to bless our children, those in this community and those we love beyond it. During the season of Lent, may each of us intentionally make space to be in God's presence. May we feel that we are of value just in who we are as children of God. We belong, we are beloved, and may that knowing impact our children. Children, may you know you are loved just as God created you. Arm in arm, may we grow together in love together and show love to the world. Children, please meet with Barb and Joan at the back of the sanctuary. Families with babies and toddlers, you are invited to bring your children to spend time playing in our nursery.
Thank you.
This is our time where we bring our full selves in confession to God, time to speak the truth about where and how we are living, a time to receive God's assurance of forgiveness and grace. So would you all join me in this prayer? God of all creativity, beauty, and grace, when we feel stressed, bent out of shape, and unable to change, restore us to our true self. As a mother comforts her child, so says God, I will comfort you. God of all loving, vulnerability, and care, when we feel unloved, unlovely, and uncared for, embrace us with your healing grace. As a mother comforts her child, so says God, I will comfort you. God of all believing, longing, and transforming, when we are filled with self-doubt or distrust, and when we feel hopeless, help us to see ourselves through your eyes. As a mother comforts her child, so says God, I will comfort you. Mother and God, as you have brought us to birth, fed us and nurtured us with your love, seen in us the possibilities and the potential of who we might become, so may your gift of life-giving, horizon-stretching mothering overflow in us and touch those around us with your love. I invite you to just a moment of silence as you listen to the birds singing outside. And know that God holds us and covers us with her wings. Our God loves us tenderly, remembers that we are but dust. And so let's together assure ourselves of this forgiveness. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and free. Amen. The tradition of passing the peace in worship is something that comes from the ways that Jesus always came into the room, especially after his resurrection, when he would just come in and say, peace be with you. And so we continue to extend peace to each other. And so let us stand and greet each other with the peace of Christ, and you online to say hello and say peace to each other as well. The peace of Christ be with you.
Our song of invitation is number 59, The Steadfast Love of the Lord. We'll sing through it twice.
So our scripture, our reading this morning is from the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, chapter 17, verses 1 through 13. There's two stories here, water from a rock and Israel defeats Amalek. Water from a rock. The whole Israelite community broke camp and set out from the Sin Desert to continue their journey as the Lord commanded. They set up their camp at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people argued with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why are you arguing with me? Why are you testing the Lord?" But the people were very thirsty for water there, and they complained to Moses, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us, our children, and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What should I do with these people? They are getting ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go ahead of the people and take some of Israel's elders with you. Take in your hand the shepherd's rod that you used to strike the Nile River and go. I'll be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Hit the rock, water will come out of it, and the people will be able to drink." Moses did so while Israel's elders watched. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites argued with and tested the Lord, asking, "Is the Lord really with us or not?" And then Israel defeats Amalek. Amalek came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. Moses said to Joshua, "Choose some men for us and go fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I'll stand up on top of the hill with the shepherd's rod of God in my hand." So Joshua did as Moses told him. He fought with Amalek while Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. Whenever Moses held up his hand, Israel would start winning the battle. Whenever Moses lowered his hand, Amalek would start winning. But Moses' hands grew tired, so they took a stone and put it under Moses so he could sit down on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on each side of him, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his army with the sword. For the word of God in scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
Thank you. Competence can be a curse. Competence can be a curse. This is the opening line for Min Jin Lee's novel, Free Food for Millionaires. When she was recently asked, "What do you mean by that line?" she says this. "I think this happens to a lot of high-functioning people. We think that we can do everything, And in our process of doing everything, we don't do the thing that matters the most. We don't do the things that take the greatest risks because we are so competent. And often we're overtaxed by our competence and we don't know that. Often we're overtaxed by our competence and we don't know that. The very wise Ralph Ornes once said to me, "Your problem, Jenny, is that you're good at everything." Now, I'm not good at everything. Do not have me direct or even be in the bell choir. Do not ask me to conduct the choir like Ralph. Do not ask me to teach you piano like Barbary. Do not ask me to coach football. Do not ask me to program software. There is a lot that I'm not good at. But it turns out I'm pretty good at running a church in a pandemic. I love a creative challenge. I was afraid you would do that, but I love a creative challenge. I have video editing and graphic design skills. I know how to run a decent Zoom meeting. I'm creative with things like drive-through communion and worship at home kits. And I was a quick study on things like MailChimp and web design and YouTube. I write a lot of thank you notes, and I check my email 7 days a week. And I didn't make sourdough bread at home, but I did make sourdough crackers and pancakes and marmalade for the neighbors. And I perfected some fantastic cocktails. This all of it, came in handy the last 2 years. And if you want to talk to someone who has been overtaxed by her competence, I'm your gal. One reason I think I was a good choice for pastoring this church is to be a competent person among a lot of other very competent people. So yes, I'm looking at all of you. We are pretty competent folks, and we pay a price for that competence. Our competence keeps us from taking the risks to do what matters most. Our competence distracts us from listening to what might be below the surface of things. Our competence propels us through life at a pace that is unsustainable for our souls. Our competence keeps us mistaking our competencies for our worth. Our competence deceives us into thinking we are defenseless and alone in the world without competency. Moses was also a really competent guy. He had grown up in a royal household as an adopted or foster child, however you want to think of it, likely having access, though, to all the privilege without having been born to it. His questioning of the systems and the structures of Egyptian culture led him to flee to the desert, where one day he met God in a burning bush after years of being there, years long enough to have married and have a new family. And it's here where I'd like us to pick up today. In Exodus 3, God sees Moses right smack in the middle of the desert. His privilege and his trauma, in the midst of all that, he is asked to be the conduit for freeing the people of his birth, the children of Israel. And Moses has a few questions for God. The first question is, who am I? Who am I? It's a question of his worthiness, to which God answers, "Don't worry about being worthy. You are enough just as you are because I am with you." Moses asks another question, "What happens when they don't believe me?" This is a question of credibility. To which God answers, "Okay, I see that you're going to need a coping device here, and maybe even a little bit of a crutch. So let me give you a little trick that you can play. There's your shepherd's staff, and I'm going to give it some power. So when you throw it down, it will become a snake, or if you strike water, the water will become blood, or you can strike a rock, as we heard earlier, and make water come out of it. This is kind of like your magic tool that you can use as you go about this calling." Moses asks, "But what about the places where I am not competent? I'm not a great speaker. Now, if there's one thing competent people can't stand, it's not being competent at something that they're asked to do. To which God answers, I gave you your mouth, so don't worry about it. But no, says Moses, really, I am not comfortable speaking in front of all those people. And so God allowed Moses' brother, Aaron, to speak for him. And it turns out that Moses did quite a bit with that staff and with his brother as his mouthpiece. This weekend at our women's retreat, I've been speaking and sharing this space with two of my dear friends, and you're going to hear from Brittany in just a minute, but my friend Laurel, who's a therapist and artist, talked about the ways that our belovedness gets hidden by our crutches and our coping devices and our dependencies and our competencies. So she did a little illustration with us, and I want to invite her up to help me with one. And so, Laurel, if you just stand like right here, you're going to be Moses, just as you are. This is kind of me making up for telling a story about men on a women's retreat weekend. So you're Moses, and here's your staff. Can you just put that right in front of you? Okay, great. All right, and then, so you've got here you are, and your belovedness, just perfect as you are. Ready to do what God has called you to do, but you kind of need this in front of you to help you get through, kind of hold on, play a few tricks. Great. And then you also need a brother, but in this instance, I'm going to ask for sisters. So I'm going to ask Margie Lee to come down and be Aaron. I don't know, what would you call, we call you Arena or something? I don't know. So you're going to stand right in front of Laurel. Great. So this is Moses', composition here. Moses is beloved by God enough all and on his or her own. And in front is the staff and then his brother and probably a few other things that we can't see that got developed over time. And God did amazing things with all of this. But all of these things can only get us so far. And eventually, some of those things get a little tired. So Aaron, you can go and, go build a golden calf or something. And and this staff is going to get a little heavy. So, you're done with that. And here you are as Moses, all on your own, a little tired, needing a little help. You can go sit down. Thank you, Laurel. In the story that Rian read, we see Moses doing his thing, fielding the needs of his people, performing miracles with his rod and his staff. And then Israel goes to battle, and Moses gets tired. All of these competencies run their course. And Moses has to sit down. He needs someone else to hold up his hands. Must have been incredibly hard for a guy like Moses. A direct hit to all the ways that he'd been succeeding in life. And it's interesting, if you peek into the next chapter, into Exodus 18, you see Moses' father-in-law coming and telling him that he can't do it all alone and to help him form a team of people to help him in his leadership. Competence can be a curse. A lot of us have found the limits of our competencies in the last 2 years. I know I have. The unfolding of these times have been especially hard on those of us who pride ourselves in our competence, because it turns out there are things we just can't outsmart and cannot outrun. I love the way the philosopher and theologian Jack Caputo refers to God as the unconditional. God is the unconditional one who meets our competence and says, I am, and that is enough. You are, and that is enough. God, who is the unconditional, dares us to rest in the unconditional, to just be here. And it is here that God invites us to return to our belovedness, to the places where we can hear God say, I am who I am, and I love you just as you are, and that is enough. God does not ask for our competence, only for our trust. We've been singing and talking about these words, I will be still and still here. I recognize how difficult that is for me because there's always one more thing to do. And yet maybe this is the greatest act that we can do, is to be still, is to lay down our competencies. And remember God's promise to us that God will fight for us. Fight for us, fight for our world to flourish and to grow. Allow us to be able to be still. So I'm going to invite us to just be still for a moment together. And maybe just to take a moment. The things that are blocking your belovedness, things that maybe you've put in place or have been handed to you, busyness that keeps you going. Just lay that down for a minute. As my friend Brittany comes and reads a poem to us.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. I know that you are tired, that your arms are heavy from the weight of the sword you've been carrying, that can no longer lift in your own defense. Your fingers grip the handles of familiar weapons that you have wielded in previous showdowns, weapons that you know how to use very well. But they are just not working on this battlefield. Losing your grasp on your shield, on that brave face you put on every morning, like it's the only thing standing between you and annihilation. I know that you're standing alone on the shores of the Red Sea, watching Pharaoh and his army cascade towards you on a wave of chariots. You've escaped them once before, and they just keep coming after you. You can't seem to get a break from this struggle. And you're wondering if suffering is the only constant that you can count on. I hear your shouts to the heavens. What now? Why? Where are you now? Why have you forsaken me? Why here? Why now? What now? What God? Where are you? I know that you are out of hallelujahs, out of amens and praise gods, that you're tired of people telling you to just trust God when you feel like you haven't seen me in a while. Seems like I don't live up to my title of master of the universe when your world falls to pieces and it seems like I've done little to stop it. I feel the sting of your loneliness. I felt it before you got here. I feel the agony in your limbs as you go to raise your sword again, feeling like I've left you to fight alone, like I'm up there on some throne, safely removed from your wounds where I cannot help you, and you cannot get to me. Your cries go quieter with every disappointment, and your shield of faith is replaced by apathy with every heavy circumstance that you can't wrap your head around. But can I tell you something? It may be hard for you to hear me on that lonely place on your battlefield, but I am here too. And my sword is not heavy. So put yours down and let me fight for you. My shield can take the blow of any foe that dare oppose you, even if that foe is your own self. Even when you think that I am your foe, I still do not know how to leave you. Forsaking you is a practice that I will never study, so come close to me. And watch me throw Pharaoh's army into confusion. When they come for you, they come for me. So watch me cover you with a cloud by day and light your path with fire at night. Watch me walk you through the middle of the Red Sea on dry ground, surrounded by water that won't touch you, but will drown anything that tries to stop you. Watch me bring you safely to the other side, just as I have done 1,000 times, and I will never tire of reminding you. I will never weary when you worry. My wonders still work, even when your faith doesn't seem to, and I know you can't feel it or see it with your own eyes, so close yours and trust mine. Believe what I have seen, what I have said. The words I speak to you are meant to be your sight, so let me handle this. A master jigsaw puzzle fixer, I make masterpieces out of all your broken pieces, so hand them over. Put down your weapons and come stand with me right here at the edge of your Red Sea and remember that I never stop fighting for you.
Thank you, Brittany. I'm going to invite Courtney and Katy and Ginny to come and sing for us. They're dear friends of mine who are visiting from Central Valley and from Southern California. And Joy's gonna be playing with them. And they'll share a song that Courtney wrote with us. And I'd like to invite all of you to give to this community, whether it be online or as you leave in the back this morning. Thanks.
Come or not, and this here little flower. giving you to watch. I heard them singing every day thereafter, beckoning me out,
beckoning me out.
But I wouldn't let go of the bag I carried. I didn't wanna put it.
Would you pray with me? Oh God, we come and join you in the garden. Humbled by your waiting, we also pray that those flowers would begin to grow in our world, that together we would gather and tend to the garden of your love and see it spread in justice, in freedom, in forgiveness, in grace, in wholeness, and in peace. This morning, we very specifically bring to you places that we long to see peace, especially in the Ukraine. Our hearts and our souls are with the people that are looking for peace and looking for justice there. We pray for wisdom and breakthroughs, that your strength that does not make war, be seen there. In the places where there is also war in our souls, in our communities, we pray that we would be peacemakers there too, walking in the ways of Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our God who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you all to stand as we sing our final hymn. We'll sing song number 314, Longing for Light. We wait in darkness, verses 1, 2, and 5. Christ be our light. Let's sing together. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world," and he didn't ask for your resume when he said it. So go out into this world and be that light as we together build a more loving world in the way of Jesus Christ. Amen. Go in peace.